If I say Union Club of Phoenixville, what does that mean to you? Have you ever heard of this club? It's a little known piece of Phoenixville history and a great story. Before there was a National Football League, there were football clubs in many cities. During the first two decades of the 20th century, Eastern Pennsylvania was a hotbed of gridiron activity as teams from Pottstown to Philadelphia's Schuylkill region vied for regional bragging rights. The Phoenixville Union Club, known as Big Red, was one of those teams. You might be surprised to learn about Big Red's accomplishments. Hi, I'm Lou Beccaria, and welcome to our new show called And Now You Know. The Union Club of Phoenixville began in 1907 and lasted until 1921. Recently, I sat down with Jack Ertel of the Phoenixville Historical Society to dig a little deeper into this fascinating sports subject. Check out my interview with Jack after this short word from our sponsor.
We live in a world of banks that are too big to fail. Small banks are acquired by mega banks, and then you and your money are stuck in the middle. But it's different here. At Phoenixville Federal, we are the last community bank standing. We have over 100 years experience investing in this community, and we truly care about what happens in our town. So when you do your banking with us, your dollars are helping to grow our local economy, because we invest in local businesses and families that make up this great community.
Jack, thanks for inviting me down to talk about the Union Club of Phoenixville. Probably a lot of people don't realize that we had a football team here in Phoenixville.
Well, people always think about communities like Phoenixville having high school teams and high school sports, or if it's a college community, a college team. But in the early part of the 20th century, a lot of communities had what we would call semi-pro teams. Mm-hmm. Phoenixville, Pottstown, Norristown, Conshohocken, all of these communities had teams. Often they wouldn't last very long, but they were part of the community, really, and people, they would charge admission. Guys would work all day, all week long, and then they'd end up playing games on Saturdays, practice for a couple hours early evening. And it's an interesting part of early football history, really, because it was pretty open-ended. The rules were very different.
Yeah, it's a tough duty to work in a steel mill and then go out and play football afterwards.
Oh, yeah. On your feet all day.
So tell me, what were some of the teams that were in this kind of makeshift league that you're talking
about? Well, leagues came and went, and they would be kind of unofficial leagues. Pottstown had a team for a long time. Conshohocken had a team. Norristown. Philadelphia had a lot of different teams. There was a team in Holmesburg. Probably the most well-known team in Philadelphia were the Yellow Jackets, the Frankfort Yellow Jackets. There were teams in the Allentown, Lehigh Valley area, a team called the Bethlehem Blue Stars. There was a team in Lancaster that played semi-pro football called the Lancaster All-Americans. So there were a lot of these teams, but they'd often last for a couple of years, run out of money or get into financial trouble, and they'd fold up. So teams would proclaim because of their winning record that they were the champions of Southeast Pennsylvania or the Delaware Valley, but there weren't really...
Self-declared
champions. Yeah, they're really self-declared. Yeah. The Phoenixville teams were kind of that way. In the 1890s, there was a team called the Phoenix Athletic Association. They lasted 9 or 10 years. And then in 1907, somebody came up with the idea of restarting a community-wide sports team. Uh-huh. And that became the Union AC.
Now, I understand that they were called the Big Red.
Yes.
Why Big Red? That seems a little unusual.
Well, when they had their organizing meeting, they voted on what color jerseys to order. And the jerseys came in, they were bright crimson. Mm-hmm. And they stuck with that color through their whole 15 years of existence. When they started winning games and winning big, the newspapers kind of gave them the label the Big Red.
I see.
It's like calling the Cincinnati the Big Red Machine, back in the 70s. So that's where the nickname came. Most people around them just called it the Union Club.
Okay. Is there any connection between the name Union Club and the union workers in the steel mill?
Well, that's kind of a fuzzy area. The suggestion is, of course, that the iron company was the dominant industry of Phoenixville turn of the century. And a lot of these guys may well have worked in the iron industry. Mm-hmm. Now, Phoenixville wasn't much of a union town back in those days. So to call it the Union Club might have been pushing the envelope a little bit.
Okay. So was this team, the Union Club, any good at all?
Well, they won several championships unofficially over the years. And in fact, in their lifetime, the worst record they ever had was to lose 3 games one season. And wow. In the course of their 15 years of history, they only lost 8 games. And in fact, they tied more games than they lost.
Well, that answers the question. They were pretty good.
And somebody had tallied up their scores from all their games, and they outscored their opponents. They scored a little over 2,300 points in their career and gave up less than 300 points.
Wow.
So they were a pretty dominant team.
I'll say.
Of course, now a lot of them, when they were really successful, weren't guys from Phoenixville. They were ringers.
Now, was the game very similar to what we know as football today?
Well, football was still 11 guys. However, most of the players played 2 ways.
Okay.
And like the Union Club only had about 20 players. And you'd often see a game and it would show that the 11 starters and they list 3 guys as substitutes. So when they played the Canton Bulldogs, which we'll talk about in a little bit, they only used 14 guys in the entire game.
Holy man.
And that included the kickers and everything. So, I mean, this is men were men, right?
Yeah.
And pretty rugged. The forward pass was only made legal in 1906. So the Ohio State stories you and I heard as kids, 3 yards in a cloud of dust, mm-hmm. was kind of the standard. That's where the stereotype comes from.
Yeah.
And of now, course,
go ahead.
But the equipment, I mean, you look at the equipment. Here's the team in 1907.
Looks like a rugby team.
Yeah, now you look at the clothing that they're wearing for padding.
Yeah.
It's kind of quilted, no helmets, pretty tough. So you took a real pounding.
Yeah, probably a lot of concussions back then, but that wasn't a topic back
ringing
then.
Ringing their bell, they would call it, ringing their bell.
Now tell us about the historic big game against the Canton Bulldogs with the famous Jim Thorpe.
Well, the big game actually comes about because of the team almost going out of existence. World War I had a devastating effect on the teams in these communities because the United States entered the war in April of 2017 and a draft was put in. So a lot of these guys were prime candidates to be drafted into the military, and all over the United States, a lot of these teams would wither away for lack of players.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of them would merge with other teams, etc. In 1 year, the Union Club, because of that, only played 1 game for the entire season. They had trouble finding wow. opponents. Just when the war was coming to an end, the United States and the world was hit with this great influenza epidemic that probably most of your viewers never heard of. But there was a flu epidemic hit the world that killed upwards of 10 million people. This is pre-antibiotic era when yeah. they die of high fever and dehydration. And the Union Club really struggled to survive. And in 1920, a group of people came forward and he decided they're going to rejuvenate the team. And that was a man by the name of Pops Keenan in mm-hmm. Phoenixville. And he hit on the idea of a community-based, community-owned team.
Kind of like the Green Bay Packers.
Yeah, very much so. And he called for a meeting of 50 prominent business people in the Phoenixville community. They all met in town here at St. Peter's Episcopal Church, right down the street from us, and asked people to buy shares of stock in the company for $5. Mm-hmm. And their goal was to raise $7,000. In 4 days, they raised enough money and began to recruit players. Now, they recruited players from all over the place. This is the fellow that's the key figure in all of it. His name's Heinie Miller. He was an All-American lineman from the University of Pennsylvania, had graduated a couple years earlier, was a pro football player. And he helped recruit players.
Okay.
The Union Club team of 1920 had 13 college All-Americans on it,
wow.
including the quarterback from Notre Dame of the year before, a man named Stan Kofel. So they went out and they beat up teams. They beat up teams.
That kind of a
played their season-ending game after being undefeated with the Frankfurt Yellow Jackets, and defeated them handily before a crowd of over 17,000 people. And the newspapers billed them as world champions.
Yeah.
They weren't really world champions. The professional league in the Midwest got upset about it, and the Canton Bulldogs, who were the 1919 champions, challenged them to a game. So that's where the big game comes from.
Okay.
It was held in Philadelphia in Baker Bowl, the Phillies Stadium. Mm-hmm. More than 12,000 people attended, and the Union Club won the game 13-7. The thing that made it interesting is the Canton Bulldogs were, their legendary leader was Jim Thorpe, one of the greatest athletes of the 20th century. And Jim Thorpe was the leader of the whole backfield were made up of American Indians, interestingly enough. And the newspaper accounts are that between the 25-yard lines, the Canton Bulldogs went up and down the field, but they only got one touchdown. They fumbled the ball, the Union took it over, threw a pass, scored, and shut them out the rest of the game, and they won 13-7. So the Union Club proclaimed itself in the local media as the world champions because we beat the Canton Bulldogs.
Yeah, with Jim Thorpe.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Now, we only have about a minute left, but I'd like to ask you the final question here. Did any of these really great players for the Union football team go on to play for other teams after the Union team folded?
Well, the Union team folded after the 1921 season for financial reasons primarily. But a lot of these guys continued on playing for other pro teams. In fact, the Union team had six players that were part of the Buffalo All-Americans. And they would take a train from Buffalo, play on Saturday, and take a train back to Buffalo and play on Sunday. These guys were rugged. And to top it off, a lot of them would play through the 1920s. Mm-hmm. One of the key figures from the Union Club was a man named Lud Ray, was an All-American lineman from Penn. In the early 1930s, he and Burt Bell purchased the Frankfurt Yellow Jackets and renamed them the Philadelphia Eagles, which is an interesting little touch.
So we're in the lineage
Absolutely, Philadelphia Eagles. In many, many ways. Another one of their linemen from Penn was a man named Lou Little, a legendary coach. He's in the Coaches Hall of Fame, coached at Georgetown, and then was the head coach at Columbia University into the 1950s.
Yeah,
so there are a lot of people from that Union Club team that played on other teams and went into the coaching ranks. So they're quite an interesting piece of Phoenixville history.
Yeah, I'll certainly say that. And now we know that there is a reasonable lineage for the Philadelphia Eagles here, so it's a good reason for us here in Phoenixville to be Eagles fans.
Well, there weren't any Dallas Cowboys involved anyhow.
Well, thanks very much, Jack, for inviting us down. It's really been very, very interesting. And now we know.
All right. Thank you for having me.
All right.
As you can see, Jack and I had a captivating conversation on the topic of football history right here in Phoenixville. We'll be right back with some final thoughts right after this message. The Historical Society of the Phoenixville area has an amazing amount of information about our town, and I would encourage all of you to stop by and to see it for yourself. The museum and office are open Wednesdays and Fridays from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., and the first Sunday of every month between 1 and 4 p.m., and is located at 204 Church Street. Well, that'll about do it for us, everyone. We hope that you've enjoyed the show. You can also watch this episode on our new online community channel at foxypop.com. I've been your host, Lou Beccaria. Thanks for watching, everyone. And now you know.